And how many Samudghata are there? If they can ask this question.
Seven.
And how many did we discuss last time?
Two.
So the third one is? So we discussed Vedaniya Samudghata and Prakaya Samudghata. And today we are going to deal a little bit of death projection, that is Maranantik Samudghata. So that which happens at the end of life is Maranantik. That which happens at the moment of death, Maran, is Maranantik. So Maranantik Samudghata is yet another Samudghata, and it's a very common phenomenon, if you see, right? When people are almost about to die, they start talking about very weird things. And then people think, oh, they are gone crazy, they don't understand, they don't have senses, they have got the issues with because of too much of drugs. And the weird things could be probably because they have traveled to a distance and they have seen some other land. So there are people who say, I've been invited, and like, you know, there's some family member who's already passed off. They have come and they are waiting for me and they're calling me, or they have come to receive me, things like that. Or sometimes people have fearful scenes, like they're very fearful and a very traumatic situation comes to their experience. So again, we're not sure what's going on because it's all in the subjective world. But one of the possibilities is a person who is about to die could actually travel to that place of their birth and return back and then go for death. Or they might go there and even die there without returning back. So the possibility of reaching to the birthplace even before your next birth starts off is death prediction. Interesting? So here what happens is when the soul is again, as I think I mentioned in my last session, that Vedana and the pain and emotion, these two actually are factors which could tie up with death projection. So death projection and pain projection could go together in the sense that there is pain and then death happens, or there is emotionally disturbed state and death happens, or during death, which is about to happen, the person gets emotionally disturbed, or there is too much of pain. Because when we say the soul leaves the body, and it says that if, you know, there are the rom kut kehte hain Hindi mein, so the hair, the, what do you call this?
Goosebumps.
Hmm? Yeah, so basically there are so many, and if the soul has to leave from each of it, it's like a, if there is a pin, you prick it on each of them, how much it's going to be painful. So death could be painful for some, death could be easy for others. We've seen different kinds of people going through different experiences. And it also would depend on how much of meditational practice you've had, how much of stillness you have, how much of detachment you have, and what is the next mode of life. So there is an important phrase that in the lesha in which you die, the same lesha you are born in, right? What is lesha?
Aura.
Okay. Very simple definition of lesha could be aura. And in subtleness, lesha means like vitano, adhyasaya, and there are, there's an inner state of being. And that state which one is dying in would be same state when one is born. So if a person is dying happy, is born happy. If a person is dying in a miserable state, in the sense of emotionally miserable, then it's not like physical state which transfers to the next life, but the emotional state does persist in the next life. So that's the reason we say death should be peaceful, death should be in detachment, death should be with the ease rather than too much worrying, too much crazy going and thinking about the other stuff around the world. Because the kind of situation you're in at the last, the same will actually appear in the next world. So we take very care about this because of this concept. So here when some people are trying to say that they are seeing some Viman, the probability is they've gone to next, they've gone to Devlok and they've seen something in the somewhere. But how the duration of this is how long? Antarmur. What big antarmur? How much is antarmur?
48 minutes. One samay less than 48 minutes.
So it's actually 48, one samay less than 48 minutes. So it's kind of 47 minutes. But any we call antarmur. And so the duration is short. It's not like a long time the person can stay in that whole process. Now, the other interesting thing is when we talk about death and birth, what is the time lapse between death and birth?
Four samay.
Four samay. Sorry?
Ayushya.
No. If your Ayushya is not bound, you will not die. Mm-hmm. The destination, the next place, the address, Apu Parayimandha. Right? And there is no navigator which would fail to make you reach there. So there is no way of liberation out there. In Buddhism, there is a concept called bardo todi. Bardo. So bardo, they consider is a gap between death and rebirth. So here they would say that when a person is dying or dead, they would recite that scripture called bardo todi in the ear of the person, and that scripture could serve as a guideline to help you reach or escape rebirth or attain a good birth. For example, if the person in the first attempt of the bardo recitation catches the message, and at that time the person would see a light. If the person does not identify itself with the light or something, and there's a situation how he had to respond, and if he or she does not respond in the way they should be doing it, they can escape rebirth and attain liberation. So here in Buddhism, there is the concept that your next birth could be changed in your transit journey by your awareness. But in Jainism, that's not the case. And here again, they say that suppose you miss the first opportunity, there's a second opportunity. And if you get awareness in the second opportunity, you could get to a good birth, better birth. And then if you have a third opportunity, if you miss the second, in the third, you would, if you are aware in the third moment, third opportunity, you are actually going to get a good life rather than a worse life. But if you miss all of them, you are destined to what you are, basically. So even in Hinduism, there is a notion of the 412 days and the soul is lingering around and all that stuff. But Jain theory is, you know, the soul doesn't take much time to reach the next destination, and birth actually happens instantly. So what is the maximum time one takes to reach the next destination?
Four
samay. And again, it could be one samay, two samay, three samay, four samay. What is samay, by the way?
Fraction of a second.
Fraction of a second. Don't think it, but still. Even once in one blink, there is innumerable samay passed off. So the samay actually in Jainism is a unit of time. For us, if you go by nanoseconds, is what we've been talking about as a very subtle time. Like we have hours, then minutes, then seconds, and then nanoseconds, and then whatever, you know, science might have gone to a little further than that. But Jainism says the last unit of time which you cannot break it into two. That is samay. And it is so subtle that even in a blink, it could be infinite time, samay just passed by. So, which means if someone has died, even within that blink of a second, the person is already there in the next place of their birth. Yeah? So, when we travel, what are the laws which works towards this travel? How does the soul get to the next destination? Who works as a navigator? You don't call them and say turn left and right. That doesn't work. In Buddhism, it does work because there is a bardo todi text, and then they would say, okay, stay aware. You might get a chance to be released. In Jainism, that's not the case. But still, there should be a navigator, isn't it? How does the soul know where to go?
Well, it travels in a straight line.
Who tells the soul ki straight ke baad left jana ki right jana?
Soul itself.
Ho sakta hai straight upar jana ki niche jana hai. Which one do you prefer, going straight up or down?
Up.
Maybe it's the big karmic and something yeah. to enter the life.
How much expansion?
Where we are going to face through your karma?
Yes, it's. But it is the karmic body, which is actually an tejas body, which accompanies the soul. So there is actually another karma called anupurvi karma. So that karma actually would help you, guide you through the next life destination. And it's very interesting that when we talk about travel, the soul has a specific cosmic rule which we apply, which means that the travel is always in a straight line. It cannot be oblique. So from here to that corner, it cannot just travel like this. It cannot be oblique travel. It should be straight line. So it could be horizontal or vertical. And depending on which other end of the universe one is, the travel actually would be taking that much of time. So if one is dying here and has to be born just on top of the universe somewhere, for example, moksha, you go there, is a here release and you're there in the next moment. So then the question arises, how does one reach there? So for example, the soul is here, let's make a human being, and then one is supposed to be born here. Or it could be a devaloka. I mean, of course, we are not talking about the liberation. But so, if one has to come here to here, how much time does one take to reach here? One samay. Yeah. So one samay actually is, I said, unit of time where it cannot be broken down into two. So then, if one has to be born here, how much time does it take? There's no half samay, right? Yeah. Remember that. Yeah. Which means, one, how can one be here? So generally the rule of speed we say is if it takes an hour to reach here, the half distance it's going to take half an hour. So the rule which applies in our general travel about speed and space and time is not applicable here. And this special travel which is called apusmangati. So this is a travel which is called what's interesting is it now the way we understand it is it travels without touching the intermediate space. It's here and it's here. It's not actually if it has to reach here and then here, there should be a halfway journey, half time duration, and the laws actually should apply differently. But that's not happening because in the same moment it's here and it's here. So this is a special kind of travel which we call apusmangati, where the travel is without touching the intermediate space. Now again, in science we talk about subtle travel and subtle journey. But this is, I think, a very little different concept. And the other word we use is Rishugati, which means travel is in straight line. So in context of in temporal context, it is apusmangati, where it doesn't touch the intermediate space, and Rishugati is a straight line journey. Now suppose a person has to be born here. What happens? There is no oblique travel. So one would actually reach here and then take a right turn and then reach there. So here, from here to here, it is one samay. From here to there, it is second samay. And it takes two samay to complete its journey. Now, why do we need four samay then? Right? So suppose someone has to be born in a very different angle and it is being born here, then it could be three samay, and four samay is yet another possibility. So if anyone of you, you're familiar with the low concept, right?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So suppose one is somewhere here, let's take it to human land, and one has to be born, which is the central column which I made, any idea? Yes. What is the thing? What is unique about this, Nani? What is the uniqueness of personality?
Sorry, what is the question?
Okay, so this column I made in between is called Prasnadi.
Prasnadi.
Yeah, what is the significance? What is unique about Prasnadi?
Only mobile.
Yes, very good. So, there are two kinds of living beings in this universe. Mobile beings and immobile beings, thrust and stavar. So like for example, plants are
stavar,
and humans and other animals are all living beings. So the mobile beings are all in the central column here, which is called thrust nadi. It should have been here like this. And outside this thrust nadi, in this area, it is only stavar, which is immobile beings. And here it is mobile beings. Now suppose one is here and has to be born here. Then how does that work? So it's, suppose it's here, it comes inside the first column, it takes a journey inside, it gets out. So basically, they make four. One, two, three, and four, right? I'm not very good at making diagrams, but I think it gives you a little idea of how things work. Yeah? So let me make it here, like so. Yeah? So you see here, if one is born down there, so let me remove the column to make it more visible. You see? So suppose this is the way it goes. So it takes four moments to actually reach to the other end. So there are very rare occasions where these immobile beings are traveling from one end of the universe to the other end of the universe. So suppose even one is here, for example, if one is here and is to be born here, it just would not travel straight line down there. Like for example, from here to here, there is no way to reach. So one has to enter into the thrust column, get down, get out, and then be born. So there are occasions where it would take these longer time duration for reaching the other end of the universe. So we got an idea how the time lapse to reach to the next destination is depending on where we are going to be born. And who decides that? It is karma, of course, but it is also the time when the Aishu karma is being bound. If at that time how your state is, does have a big role to play. And when that is binding, when does your next life Aishu karma is decided? Is it decided or not? Decided ho gaya? Chandika ho gaya? Leela kabhi ho gaya? No idea. How many of you have said we have decided already where to get away? You address kya hai uska? Destination kya hai?
Actually, no one wants to leave. First point.
No one wants to leave. Actually, 2/3 of your life is spent and 1/3 is remaining. At that time, you decide when you're going to actually go next life. Now, have our 2/3 life passed off? We don't know. You can't imagine your life is short or long. The other thing is, if you miss to decide at that time, then the rest of the life, 2/3 passes by, and then you decide. So it's like, for example, the 90 years is the age. So then what is the two-third?
60.
60 ho gaya, then you actually, the decision is made. If you don't do that at that time, how many is remaining?
30.
30. So 30 ka two-third nikal gaya to?
20.
20 is gone at that time, you take the decision. And this way, there could be a time when the last hour of the death, one can decide where one is going. Because sometimes the person is not decided, and then it gets postponed, and so it goes on and on, but the two-third is remaining, and then one-third. So it could even happen at the last time of your life. But again, so the awareness of living a good life, because you don't know when your decisions are made, it's better to be good always, right? To be on the safe zone. And when we talk about this four-moment journey, there are some acharyas who say, consider that there could be an occasion where the five moments are also taken to travel. But again, that's very rare, and very few people, few scholars do mention that. This whole picture was also mentioned here, because the way we travel after death, similarly the travel between Marana and Samudghata. So it would be very quick, it would be in the same manner in those pathways which you go, and you travel by Anushreni Gati, which means you travel only in the meridian, you don't take an oblique travel. So whether if the person is going to be taking a two-moment journey after birth, after death, the same could be the case where one takes two in Maranatik Samudghata. So the way the Maranatik Samudghata is picturized is similar to how the transit journey is depicted. The most interesting thing is one could leave from here, reach there, and then die. Yeah? Am I making sense? What would happen? What would be the death or birth process if this is the case? Yeah? Okay. So one is here, expanded till here, and here, right? So now the connection gets cut off here. The birth is started. No? कौन सी प्रोसेस बाकी है? इससे क्या हो गया? इधर खत्म हो गया. One moment from here to here, second moment from here to there, and when it's almost here, the connection खत्म हो गया. The moment the connection is gone, the switch is off. What happens? There's no light. So no light. The soul actually cannot stay in that body. The soul retrieves itself to this place. In this situation, soul is retrieving from here to here, and the birth process starts off there. So naya life shuru ho gaya hai. And in that new life, interestingly, the soul is half outside and half in. Even when you're being born in that new life, you need not have
condition or
that's my question. But well, we don't say samudgat because the birth body is actually started formulating, and the soul is retrieving back. So the description doesn't mention that this is a birth samudgat. I mean, that doesn't come about. It is our crazy mind which starts thinking.
Which form? Which form soul is?
Okay, so what we are dealing with here, when we talk about birth, we are talking about the first moment of conception. When the first moment when the soul comes into the womb, or soul comes into wherever the place of. Yeah, so it's not that the developed baby or the developed fetus. Even when the sperm ovum has united and it becomes alive, we're talking about that first moment of aliveness. Yeah? Yeah, yeah, we think.
Then what about half an hour?
Half an hour of what?
Well,
yes. Yeah, so basically, the soul is partially out in the sense. So let's put it, say it again. So one moment from here to here, second moment from there to there, death occurs here. And when death occurs, it actually, the moment death is occurring, the soul is already here.
Mm-hmm.
You see, it's very quick, very subtle, speed mein hota hai. So when we say death is, after death, the soul will retrieve. I mean, everything is happening together in that subtle time. So when death has occurred, the soul is already reached here, and birth process has started here. So death occurs here, birth starts here, soul comes here by then, and even the birth process has started off, the soul starts actually retrieving within itself. And it's all one moment thing. It's not like a big time lapse. So the soul is out, and that's the reason when we talk about the size of the soul during death or the size of the soul during birth. During birth, the size of the soul could be longer because it is in its expanded state. There are some occasions where they say that the soul is. For example, a soul is going to be born as an ant, right? So what would be the size of an ant? Very small, right? But the size could be 1 yojin long because the soul is stretched up to 1 yojin. And so it would be a very different story. Now, when we talk about what is the shape of the soul when death occurs or during Maranantik Samudghata, during Maranantik Samudghata, the shape actually is it should go with the old body shape in a sense. And like for example, when it's about birth, there are two situations which can happen. I know it's a little complicated thing. Just now, what we could grab from this overall complex model is that how detailed Jain philosophy is. And how Jain intellectual scholars and acharyas have explored so much about it from the tradition before. So it's just that the feeling of wonder how much they've written and how detailed it is, it's all about that. So there are two kinds of birth we are talking about. One is travel with the thing, with turns, and the other is travel in the straight line, isn't it? So when we talk about traveling the straight line, the situation actually would vary when compared to traveling the turns. Because when it is straight line travel, the karmas and the factors which are supposed to be functioning here starts off. So the shape and others, the karmas are not based on the old body, it is all inclined to the new body. But when it is in with turns, until it reaches there, since this is functional and this has not been activated yet, the rules, the karmas, the shape and everything is defined by the old body. So depending on what kind of birth you have, your shape also could vary based on that. So the transit journey would have different kinds of shapes based on whether the transit is short or long. If it is short, then the next life starts off functioning. So the shape and the size and the karmas are all go all related to the next life. But otherwise, it would be still something related to this one.
But it has to be traveled straight. So there is a something defined. It has to be some sort of defined shape.
Shape to hoga, but what I'm trying to say is that of course there is a shape. So suppose there is a straight line travel. We have to understand this. Again, one more thing, it's all our attempt to understand the deep philosophy. So okay, I'm Chandra if I'm not right. So if a person is like this. Or if a person is like this, right? I mean, we could just make an animal thing. when there is kind of this whole death, and I talk about straight line journey, it should be something like that, isn't it? And whether it's this animal, the shape is there. There is a different kind of form which the body has, and that kind of form, that the structure would be there, and that would be the... I mean, it is a straight travel. It is no oblique travel, but there should be some kind of form which is expanding and is an expansion, you have to understand. There are two things. In death, there is no expansion. Death, the soul leaves here, it is here then, and then it is here, right? But in case of Marana and Samudghata, it's not like from here to here a jump, it is expanded in this form. I mean, the form, if I understand it right, should have some persistence when it is moving up. Yeah, so if it's, I mean, it is stretching, but the stretching should have some shape in some form, in some way, yeah, okay. So that could vary. So death projection could happen twice. One is, one could go, come back, and then the death occurs, or one could actually go and never return back, and then the death occurs. So there are two possibilities of, there are two attempts of death projection. One is first attempt, and then there is a second attempt in the same life. So there's no more than two attempts. If the person has done second attempt of death projection, then the soul doesn't return back, then it dies in that situation. So in other way, this is also trying to say, what is the mechanism of death? Right? If you see, it is trying to say that the soul could reach there, and then there is a disconnection happening here, or the soul could disconnect and then start its travel. Soul, or the whole soul could travel in one, like a one unit, or it could travel expanded form. So there are two examples. They say Gendu Gati and Ilika Gati. So Gendu Gati actually means like a ball. The ball you throw, the ball is actually there. But Ilika Gati is like a worm travels, right? So worm, how does the worm travel? Yes, so basically it's like this, right? And then it goes like this. I mean, it keeps crawling like thing. So there are two kinds of examples being given to depict two kinds of travel. So one could go as touching the space in between, and then keep jumping to the other end. So this is again fascinating to see that how we are so much concerned about life and things and people and matter and money and all that stuff. When death occurs, don't take a second to go to your next destination. And you don't worry, because there is no failure of any process of karmic theory. You would not fail to make sure that you reach to your next birth life. Abhi agar kahin par bhi jana hai, so you're worried which direction do you take. Husband would say, we'll take this line, that this shortcut, and wife would say, no, that is too much of traffic, and we should go through the other direction or the other way around. And we have a debate about it. But it doesn't matter, we have to reach there anyways. But here there is no debate. There are laws which is governing us, and we just go by that law. Without thinking, without much effort, the karma governs, and we are there. Yeah. There is another interesting thing which I've just pointed out. There are many people who talk about near-death experience. And in most of the near-death experience, people have claimed to see a tunnel, a light, something positive. There are very few cases where they would say that it is a dreadful scene. But why is this the case? I'm not sure. Even if I try to see majority of the people, even the people who talk about death, there are majority mentioning about good things, very few would be actually saying about tough or negative things, basically. Now, the probability could be that when one is having a projection or someone thought in these negative places, and suppose one is about to be born in hell or in an animal form, and there they start feeling the energy, or they start seeing things or reaching to distant lands, that they might be in a very emotionally disturbed state, and because of that disturbed state, they might not be able to convey what's happening, in the experience might not be shared in a very proper manner. But when people are more peaceful and then they're saying things, the people around are more aware and they listen to them calmly. But if otherwise, we are more worried about the person's pain and disturbed state rather than what they are saying. We hardly care what they are saying. We just try to see what we could do for them. But note, at times it's important to see what they are saying as well, because there could be something valuable in what they are trying to convey. But our concern, our approach is more, okay, let them not be in pain, let them have this kind of comfort, and let the doctor reach on time. We are hardly bothered about their actual state of consciousness, which is crucial for the next journey. That's the reason why we talk about Santara, Samekna, and mantras during the death process, to make it peaceful and a better journey. Okay, so I would stop here, but if there's any questions, you could have taken it. Yes.
We talked about that we go in the same leisure as what we had in the last moment.
Mm-hmm.
But then our next life depends on our karma. So
yeah.
How can that change our...
So usually you would find people in their last life sometimes are very different from their whole life. Some people are very spiritual in their whole life and the last they mess up. There are some people who are very not spiritual, but they are very they detach and they're very calm at the end of the life. Now, one of the key things here is, because what's coming up in their next life is something which starts reflecting in the last stage of their life. So that's very possible. And we've seen, like, for example, the biggest example is Shreni, King Shreni. He actually died by suicide, right? He had to, well, the situation, he thought that his son is coming to kill him, and he took the diamond, put it in his mouth, and died. It was a suicidal death in a way. And where was he supposed to be born? In the hell. So you see the situation, though somehow it was negative, it came about it, and he had done that. So the last phase of life does have that feeling coming up already, how things are going to be.
So it's not really much of an effort, isn't it?
It is effort, because there are two things. One is what kind of birth you will have, a human or animal or heaven or hell. And even as an animal or in heaven or human, what kind of life would you live? So the decision of the type of life is done on these two-third time period, but the whole life, some animals live a wonderful life, humans, but they live a very rough, terrible life. So what you do is not wasted. It's a good investment. It's going to come up rightly, but if you had awareness in that two-third time period, that investment could actually, you would be born in a right place to enjoy all the right karmas. Because otherwise an animal is also enjoying the right karmas, but in their own way. So, for example, we are spiritual and we are look forward for more spiritual experience in our next lives. So to be born in a family which has a spiritual atmosphere and spiritual things, it's actually a line of some, you can stand up. Yeah, for the rest of the questions about this, we'll be taking the next session.
मंगलम भगवान वीरो मंगलम गौतमो गणी मंगलम स्थूलि भाद्राद्या जैन धर्मोस्तु मंगलम. I pay my homage to Vitrag Bhagavan Mahavir, Reverend Gurudev, respected Samudhi, brothers and sisters. Normally, we keep one person engaged in lecture, so one person is taking care of other things. But today I am here with a special purpose, Muni Sumer Malji Swami. He initiated at the age of 9 and little plus. After that, he developed himself to the spiritual growth that during his lifetime he did personal growth. 7 Jain Agamas learned by heart. Acharang, Sutra Kritang, Dasve Kalik, Nandi Sutra, and many others. He was a prominent monk and having the deep insight in Jain philosophy and Therapanth philosophy. And top of all other things, he given Diksha to 11th Acharya, Acharya Mahashramana. Normally, Therapanth Dharma Sangha is one Acharya centered Dharma Sangha, and most of 99% Diksha in the presence of Acharya himself, by the words of Acharya, by the hands of Acharya himself. But few occasions, so the two boys Udit and Mudit got ready, and it was the time of Acharya, it was the time of Muni Sumer Malji Chaturmas at Sardarshah. And the Acharya Tulsi given permission, you do Diksha at Sardarshah. And Diksha was performed. And in his experience, when he was taking the headlocks, the hair of that Muni Mudit, at that time, he felt some special vibration, and this would be a special Muni in Therapanta. And when he was a young monk, he was with other Muni Sri Ghasi Lalji Swami. So his mentor Ghasi Lalji Swami given him lot more debatical power, that how to debate with the various things, various philosophical standpoints. And during that time, he blessed him that one day you will be a great Muni and the Acharya also bow down to you. So the same thing, because for Acharya Mahashramanji, he is his Diksha Guru, and due to that point, he always respected him. And many years, I think 5, 7, 6 years, he was always with him, so always by the pat of Acharyashri, and always his pravachan before Acharyashri. And he was given the post of Mantri. Normally, Therapanth Dharma Sangha has very simple post wise, but you know, Acharya Tulsi given one post Mantri Muni to his senior monk Muni Maganlalji Swami. Similarly, Acharya Mahashramanji given his Diksha Guru the post of Mantri Muni. and he was the member of Bahusrut Council of Terapant, and then he was head of Bahusrut. So who is Bahusrut? Who dedicate himself for the knowledge, who dedicate himself for the purity of self, who dedicate himself for passing on the knowledge to upcoming generation. So we have a great memory. Every year when we used to be there, he used to give us training to the Saman, Samani, Mumuksu sisters and monks and nuns. So all these things is above his personal growth. In his personal growth, he did lot more koti japa. So he was a japi muni, crore mantras. And in his chaturmas, he laid the community for the koti japa. In Kolkata Chaturmas, 5-year Kolkata Chaturmas, and in the history of, like, we can see that one monk can stay 5 years in one place and keeping the same high esteem and high stream of the people, floor, footing, everything, because his power was miracle. And one more thing, he always think, not personally, but about the Sangha. So today, I pay my homage to that great Muni, and without any severe disease, just on the day of Akshay Tritiya, he took his last breath, and half an hour before people came, he did Mangal Path, and we both have Unnata Pragyaji during her PhD interviewed him, and during my study, just I met him and I took his blessing. So it is really a great opportunity for we all Samanijis and Sadhuji that a polyglot monk, a deep knowledgeous monk, a japi monk, a swadhyay monk was a part of Dharma Sangha, and we really feel that that vacuum could not be fulfilled suddenly because he was like a towering figure in our Terapanth Dharma Sangha and Diksha Guru of Acharya Shri Mahashramanji. So I pay my homage for his spiritual growth, and he always used to say, though we don't born in the Mahavidya Kshetra, but we born in this Kshetra and here in Bharata Kshetra, and we can develop ourselves if we are more aware about the spiritual progress. So we can develop, still there is lot more opportunity for the further development.
So I express my deep reverence for Mantini Prabhupada. I've had experience to discuss about my Samudghata topic with him. And it was very few occasions though, but every time those two or three big sessions I've had, at this age, his mind was so sharp, and he would, I would take him to all around in this subject from here to there, but he would be fine with discussing in different ways. And I also remember one occasion, there was a scriptural passage where I was not able to understand, and there I was trying to interpret somehow, and Manti Munitrava said, no, this is not the interpretation. And it, see, you read it here, it's clearly stated, and so it should be this one. Even until the last moment of the discussion, he wasn't ready to accept my interpretation. Recently, when I was thinking about it again, and I suddenly thought that let me search the meaning of this word in the Sanskrit dictionary, I explored it, and I found that I was wrong, and Muni Pravar, when he... when he stick to his view, even at the last moment, that showed that how he had his intellectual and the ability of knowledge to grab the knowledge in its rightness. Was that because, you know, sometimes if you're not consciously pure, you might end up into wrong interpretation, wrong understanding, but that was not the case with him. And he was a blessed aura, a powerful energy. Even in his last phase, he was energetic. He would be blessing people, and he lived a full life. And now he had health issues. The doctor said his hemoglobin has gone down to 4. He should be hospitalized, but he said, no, I don't want to go to hospital. I live my life the way it is. And he's sickness, and he passed off on a great day, actually. So we are indebted to him. It's a lot we've taken from him. By being in church directly and indirectly, he served the congregation a lot. So we express our deepest reverence. And there was a small clip which was, he actually was the one who also got an opportunity to celebrate his 75 years of ascetic life. I mean, we might celebrate our birthdays and anniversaries, but 75 years dedicated to an ascetic life of detachment and commitment to spirituality is a big accomplishment, especially in Bharat era, right? Bharat Kshetra. I mean, Rishabdev, and in those times, they had thousands of years of life, and so it would be fine, but per year, 100 years is our lifespan. Even he is a big part of his life dedicated to spirituality. So on that occasion, they made a small clip about his life, which we thought could be just appropriate to take a moment and look at it.
जैन धर्म में दीक्षा एक महत्वपूर्ण संस्कार है। तेरा बंधन संग में दीक्षा संस्कार का कार्यक्रम यूं तो आचार्य के सानिध्य में होता है, पर कभी-कभी विशेष स्थितियों में आचार्य की आज्ञा से दीक्षा अन्यत्र भी दी जा सकती है। पर सप्तम आचार्य श्री डालगढ़ी ने निर्धारित किया कि भविष्य में आचार्य के स्पष्ट आदेश से ही अन्यत्र दीक्षा दी जा सकेगी।
कितना पावरफुल वॉइस है ना।
नवम अधिशास्ता आचार्य श्री तुलसी के शासनकाल में अनेक साधु साधियों ने उनके निर्देश से दीक्षा प्रदान की। उनमें से एक है मुनि श्री सुमेर बल जी लाल। आप 9.5 वर्ष की आयु में दीक्षित हुए और 20 वर्ष की अवस्था में ग्रुप लीडर बने। तत्व ज्ञान व सिद्धांत के जानकार, प्रवचनकार, कथाकार और साहित्यकार के रूप में प्रसिद्ध मुनि श्री सुमेर बल जी को आचार्य श्री महाप्रज्ञ ने तेरापन दर्शन मनीषी के रूप में संबोधित किया और वर्तमान आचार्य श्री महाश्रवण द्वारा आपको मंत्री मुनि के रूप में प्रतिष्ठित किया गया है। आचार्य श्री तुलसी की आज्ञा से मुनि श्री सुमेर बल जी ने 5 मई 1974 को सरदार शहर में 2 किशोरों को संयम रत्न प्रदान किया, हीरा लाल बैर व मोहन लाल दूगढ़। हीरा लाल को मुनि हेमंत कुमार व मोहन लाल को मुनि मुदित कुमार के रूप में नई पहचान मिली। मुनि श्री सुमेर बल जी ने दोनों बाल मुनियों को श्री डूंगरगढ़ में आचार्य तुलसी को समर्पित कर दिया। कौन जानता था कि यही मुनि मुदित कुमार एक दिन तेरा पंथ के भाग्य विधाता बनकर नए इतिहास का सृजन करेंगे। उस समय आचार्य तुलसी ने मुनि हेमंत कुमार का नाम परिवर्तित कर मुनि उदित कुमार कर दिया। तब से बिछाया की तरह मुनि सुमेर बल जी के साथ मुनि मुदित कुमार की प्रज्ञा, प्रतिभा और आचार निष्ठा ने आचार्य श्री तुलसी को प्रभावित किया। गुरु कृपा बरसती गई, व्यक्तित्व निखरता गया। मुनि श्री सुमेर बल जी द्वारा दीक्षित मुनि मुदित कुमार आज आचार्य महाश्रवण के रूप में हमारा आध्यात्मिक पथ दर्शन कर रहे हैं। धर्म संघ के एकमात्र सरदार होते हुए भी आचार्य महाश्रवण अपने दीक्षा प्रदाता को इतना आदर व सम्मान देते हैं कि दर्शकों को अपने गुरु की विनम्रता और सहजता मंत्रमुग्ध कर दी।
Just we pay our homage. We did 4 logos meditation. Finally, again we decide. That day we, same day we did Samudghata Sabha. But today I think we, like in the presence of you all, we are here. So one logas meditation.
Logas jo yagare dhammati tayare jine arhante kittai sam chauri shanti kevali उद्गमनीयं च वन्दे सम्भवमभिनन्दनं च सुमयीं च पौमाह्वहं सुपासं जिनं च छन्दापहं वन्दे सुविनीं च गोपदन्नम् श्रियसिद्धं च वासुपूज्यं च विमलमरन्तं शरीरं धम्मं सन्तिं च वन्दामि कुन्तुमारं च मल्लिं वन्दे मुनिसुवयं नमिजिनं च वन्दामि सङ्गवद्धमानं च एवं मयि अभिधुवा विरुय लयमलापहीन जयमरणा चौवीसं विधिनवरा तीर्थय रामे पश्यन्तु कीर्तियवन्दियमयि जे लोगस्य